I? How about you? Yes, from Richmond, Virginia, it's the new Bob Hope Swan Show, presented by Lever Brothers Company, with our great singing star, Doris Day. Our new singing discovery, Bill Farrell. Irene Lyon, the Les Brown Band, and yours truly, Hi Averback.
We get a better break of fun. How about you?
Yes, how about you?
Who, me? Just call me Robert Gypsy Hope.
Well, how are you doing on your tour?
Well, we did our show in Mexico, and we got paid off in cactus. In Texas, they gave us barrels of oil, and tonight we're doing a show in Virginia. Anybody want to buy 3,000 poke chops?
And now, Bob Hope, Swan Dive, you of the news. Capitol Hill.
The most controversial issue before Congress this week was a proposed health plan providing compulsory medical care for the nation. Yes, sir, and under the president's plan, everybody would get free hospital service and operations. I can just see President Truman in his rubber gloves when they wheel in Drew Pearson. But imagine the government sponsoring a health program. That would lead to a lot of embarrassing situations. A pedestrian in Washington gets hit by a car, and as the ambulance speeds up, he groans, help me, I'm dying. And the doctor sticks his head out and asks, Republican or Democrat? The doctors have really made a lot of progress in recent years. Some doctor just invented a brand new tablet that has 50,000 times more fizz than Alka-Seltzer. The label on the bottle says, take one tablet, drink a glass of water, and say hello to the boys in the airlift. And it's even possible that the government may go on the air to plug this medical program. Can't you just hear Dean Acheson on your radio saying, you feel low in vitality, is your liver lavender blue minus two dilly-dillies? Take government pep syrup. It comes in three sizes, large, very large, and the Capitol Dome with a cork in it. Then Margaret Truman comes on singing, good health to all from Rexall.
Virginia.
Pausing in the middle of an exciting barnstorming trip, the Bob Hope Swan Show arrives here today. Yes, sir. Here I am on NBC from Richmond, Virginia, the home of the old gold. Jack Benny's on CBS. That's the home of the new gold. And Richmond is a very historic town. This afternoon, I visited a hotel that's a national shrine. Over the door, it says, Phil Harris slept one off here. And, you know, most hotels in America have two towels. I'll be back. How now, Brown Hotel? Well, anyway, most hotels in America have two towels in each bathroom marked his and hers. But these Southern hotels are really different. They got one marked you all. I didn't realize there were so many cigarette manufacturers down here until I arrived at the airport. A guy pushed his way through the crowd. I said, autograph? He said, no, I make Virginia rounds, and I just wanted to get a look at a Hollywood square. You'll be all right in a couple of days. I hit him with a wet cork tip, and where are we? Oh, yeah. And everyone loves it here in the South, but Les Brown's musicians, they were so disappointed when they found out Mount Vernon was a house. And on our trip... And on our trip, we passed through Texas. Texas is really big. Traveling across Texas is like ironing one of Kate Smith's dresses. Everything in Texas is really big, even the hotels. I stopped at one hotel, and I don't know how big it was, but it's the only place I ever saw that had Burma Shave signs on the way to the washroom. And while I was in North Carolina, I wanted to meet Doris Duke. Doris Duke, that's Fort Knox with a plunging neckline. And when we arrived in Virginia, the mayor made a very fine speech about our troops. Just what are carpetbaggers? And we're lucky we got here in time for tonight for the show. You know, it took our plane 22 hours to fly the 80 miles from Winston-Salem. One of Les Brown's boys poured some Southern Comfort in the gas tank, and the motor drawled all the way. If United Airlines is listening, I'm only kidding. But traveling by plane is wonderful compared to those old days in vaudeville. I'll never forget once I had to share an upper berth with a trained seal. I wouldn't have minded that so much, but I sleep curled up like a ball, and that seal had such a cold nose. And while I was down here in the South, though, I met some Southern girls, and I thought I'd get further if they didn't know I was from the North. So I said to one, I'm a direct descendant of Stonewall Jackson. She looked me over and said, if you're a Stonewall, you ought to do something about those loose bricks.
Now, here it is, proof that no matter who you are, no matter where you live, you get a better break with Swan. Just break a cake of Swan in two. That's right, ladies. The inside of the cake tells you that Swan is the best soap afloat. That you get a better break with Swan.
Just break a cake can see.
Sure, just the way I'm breaking a cake right now. Look, a smoother break. Now I press the inside of the cake. It's firm and solid, not soft and spongy. Then I press the edges. Again, firm and solid. No wasteful, crumbling edges, no matter how hard you press. That proves Swan will last longer. It's more economical. That you get a better break with Swan.
Just break a cake and see.
And, ladies, Swan is better because it's made by an exclusive, patented process that no other floating soap can use. So buy some Swan soap tomorrow. You'll discover that for dishes and your hands, for bath and for baby, you get a better break with Swan. To prove it,
just break a case and see.
Yeah, here's our delightful singing gal who will be in Greensboro, North Carolina tomorrow afternoon and Charleston, West Virginia tomorrow night to sing at the people there from Warner's picture, My Dream Is Yours, Miss Doris Day, ladies and gentlemen.
Brings happiness to me. Makes me like tears and so when a seven takes me nearer to heaven than anyone's allowed me to. So when your heart is talking, I feel like I'm walking on a cloud. But someone like you, someday I'll find someone I can boast to. Somebody to hug, a bug in a rug to snuggle up close to. And whenever I do see, you know the rule, I'll do the most. Tonight, you play on my mind, say that I find someday I'll find someone I can boast to. Somebody to hug, a bug in a rug to snuggle up close to. And whenever I do see, you never lose, I give a most to you. Play on my mind, say that I'll find someone like you for me. Until I find someone like
for the 4:30 matinee show. I just thought I'd sneak that indoors. That was wonderful. By the way, how are you enjoying your stay here in Virginia?
Oh, it's just fascinating, Bob. You know, I can't get over all the old historic landmarks down here. Why, do you know that High Atterback is staying at a place where George Washington used to sleep?
Really?
Yes, and I stayed last night in a hotel where James Madison used to live. Bob, where did you sleep?
I don't like to say, but I stuck my head out of the lid once and was sold to the American Tobacco Company.
About you, but I'm having just a wonderful time down here in the South.
Oh, so am I, Doris. Isn't that a wonderful soft drink they got down here with the leaves sticking out of it? I drank seven of them last night.
Oh! Oh, Bob, those are mint juleps. They're intoxicating.
Oh, they didn't have any effect on me.
Not much. After the third one, you rushed the General Lee statue, saluted, and said, are there any messages for my company?
I did that?
Yes.
That explains everything. No wonder.
No wonder what?
Well, the bell captain of the hotel told me I came in at 2 o'clock, introduced him to a floor lamp, and said we were engaged.
Father, it's ridiculous. You thought a floor lamp was a girl?
Yeah, I should have been suspicious. When we did the rumba, she was only using one leg. But anyway, I'm having a lot of fun here in Richmond, and I... who could that be? Come in.
I beg your pardon, Mr. Hope, but I'm a Virginia plantation owner, and I have a request to make of you.
Yeah, move back. You're getting grits all over me, boy. You have a request? What is it, boy?
Well, now, I wonder if you could use your influence to get Jane Russell to come down here.
Well, why do you want Jane Russell?
Well, I got some tobacco that's only half toasted.
The last time I hire an actor from no folk.
Maybe you would do better down here with the girls if you made them think that you were from the South.
Oh, I don't have to worry about that, Doris. I can get a girl anytime I want to. All I have to do is stand in the street corner and act like I'm on the loose.
Yeah, I know. The last time you did that, a policewoman came along and tightened you up.
Is that true? I met a Richmond girl just yesterday. In fact, I had a date with her last night.
Well, you know, I have to admit, these Southern gals really know how to get a man.
Yeah, we were sitting there in the moonlight, and she looked at me and said, "Candy pie. You're my sweet little old honey bunch of jasmine blossoms." Right then, something happened to me.
Were you bit with a love bug?
No, a boll weevil. I was wearing my cotton petal pushers. Later on, she introduced me to her father. I wanted him to think I was from Virginia, so I imitated a southern drawl.
Well, how'd you do that?
I put a chicken dumpling in my mouth and talked through the gravy. Hey, that's pretty cute, isn't it? I talked to the gravy. I made it jolly. Did you hear all that? Come in.
Hello, Doris. Hello, Mr. Hope.
Well, hello, Miss Ryan.
Say, look at that. You're wearing a whole new outfit, dress and everything.
Yes. I bought it because we're in Virginia. You see, I've always had a secret desire to be a Southern belle.
You have?
Yes. The trouble is, a belle at my age is all wrung out.
Well, the chimes are still there, but you could use some new shingles on your steeple.
Oh, Mr. Holt, you wouldn't think it to look at my figure now. But I used to be just a slip of a girl.
Just a slip, huh?
That's right. But as I got older, the slip went into a slide and everything got away from me.
Don't you just love the way these Southern women dress?
Oh, yes, Doris. So picture hats they wear with the big brims framing their face so beautifully. I went into a store to buy one, and I said to the man, "Have you got a hat that will frame my face?"
What happened?
Well, he took a look at me and said the best thing he could recommend was to knock the bottom out of a shoebox and put blinkers on.
Well, Miss Ryan, I was telling Doris how I got a Southern drawl. You see, I put a chicken dumpling.
Whenever I'm south, I'm reminded of a play we put on when I was in high school called Uncle Tom's Cabin.
Yes. That's hard to say, Uncle Tom's Cabin. Anyway, let me give you my joke about that.
Tom's Cabin was such a wonderful play, and I had the part of Little Eva.
Little Eva?
Yeah, and there was one thrilling scene. I remember I used to run across the ice dragging a piece of raw liver.
Raw liver?
Yes. I was anemic, and without that, the bloodhounds couldn't locate me.
Well, Miss Ryan, I haven't told you my joke yet.
In the play, Little Eva was supposed to be anemic, but I kind of overdid it, and being in that condition caused some confusion.
What do you mean?
Well, at the end of the play, I was supposed to die, and the stage hand was supposed to pull me up to heaven on a wire as soon as I looked dead.
Well, what about it?
He had me up there 6 times in the first act.
Well, that's very interesting, but
I wouldn't have cared about that so much, but the stage hand had the wire hooked on the wrong end of me. I'm the only little Eva in history who ever backed into heaven.
Well, that's fine. Listen, let me tell my joke.
Listen to this. If you think this is a cute outfit I've got on, you should have seen what I wore yesterday. You see, my grandmother used to be a Southern belle, and when she passed on, she left me a beautiful old-fashioned crinoline dress.
Your grandmother?
Yes. See, that's a chameleon I wore it yesterday. I wanted to get acquainted with some southern gentleman.
Oh, you did?
Yes. I saw a nice-looking man in the park, so I flirted with him in a southern way, you know. First, I fluttered my fan. Then I spin the parasol and peek out at him. Then I spin my parasol again, and then I peek out. But the second time I looked out, he was leaving. I said, "Where are you going?" And he said, "I thought if you were going to take off, I'd clear the runway."
Thank you very much, Miss Ryan. Take off for Greensboro, honey. Say, and now here's High Ever back with an important announcement. Take over, High Boy.
Bob, I want to tell everybody about 30 million little kids over in Europe who are in desperate need. We all know that they need food, but maybe some of us don't know that one of the most critically needed things is soap. That's right, the smallest sliver of soap over there is a real treasure. Because it's scarce and important, soap helps prevent disease. Sure, because nothing fights germs like cleanliness. Soap keeps morale up, too. But you know, millions of children abroad have literally never seen a cake of soap. Well, now listen. Soap is going to be sent abroad, lots of it, with your help. It's the great Swan Soap Care Plan. A plan to send white floating swan to kids in Europe through CARE, that great non-profit, government-approved organization which has delivered so many packages to the needy in Europe. Here's how the Swan Care Plan works. Buy two or more cakes of swan today. Keep the soap for your own use and mail the wrappers to CARE, Boston 1, Massachusetts, or to your local NBC station. That's CARE, C-A-R-E, Boston 1, Massachusetts, or to your local NBC station. And for every two wrappers received, Labor Brothers, the makers of Swan, will send a regular-sized cake of Swan through CARE to some kid over there. Delivery is guaranteed.
How about that? You know, when I was over in Europe last December, I saw a lot of unhappiness that could be washed away with soap and water. So take it from me that Swan will be appreciated. Keep those wrappers coming to CARE. You'll be doing a lot of good for the kids in Europe if you join in this great plan of Swan. Do that, won't you?
Buy Swan for yourself. Send just the wrappers, 2, 10, 20, as many as your heart tells you, to CARE, Boston 1, Massachusetts, or to your local NBC station. For every two wrappers, Lever Brothers Company will send a cake of Swan to a needy child in Europe. All wrappers should be mailed before August 1st, 1949. Start your Swan wrappers coming tomorrow.
Here's Les Brown bringing on our boy Baritone, who's charging towards Constitution Hall in Washington, D.C. with the rest of us to do a matinee and night show this Thursday. Mr. Bill Fall, right here.
How do you face with sunshine? Put on a great big smile. Make up your eyes with laughter. Folks will be laughing with you in a little while. Whistle a tune of gladness. Bloom never was inside. The future's brighter when hearts are lighter. So smile, smile, smile. Whistle a tune of was inside. The future's brighter when hearts are lighter. So smile, smile, smile.
Cleveland Billy, who is now reading Whitey Lewis's book, The Cleveland Indian. Get it. It's very fine. Take it, Les.
Ladies and gentlemen, Virginia has one of the most colorful histories of any state in the Union. Tonight, the Swan Players present their version of the Settlement of Virginia.
My name is John Smith. I'm sure you've heard the name John Smith before. It's on cornerstones in history books and on every hotel register in the country. I was born in London of rich aristocratic parents in the true English tradition. Before the doctor slapped me, yes, one lump or two. As a youth, I was given the best of education. I spent 2 years at the London prep school for backward children. That's where they prepare you to be a backward child. I did very well, too. I started in the eighth grade, and in no time at all, I was back in kindergarten. When I reached the age of 25, I spent most of my time in the court of Queen Elizabeth, and one day I was summoned to the chambers of the Queen's Prime Minister.
John Smith.
Yes, my lord.
The Queen has asked me to speak to you about a very personal and delicate matter which only you can handle for her.
Do I have to lux out her undies again?
No, Smith. Her Majesty desires that you set sail for America to establish colonies. You must go to Virginia.
All right, but I don't even know the girl.
Be silly, old chap. Virginia isn't a girl. Virginia's a beautiful territory with a picturesque coastline.
I guess he's never seen a girl.
Smith, you will leave next week with a fleet of 10 ships.
But I'm afraid of the ocean.
You will take a company of 300 men to clear the wilderness of Virginia.
But I'm afraid of the wilderness.
You will also take 300 of England's most beautiful women.
I'm coming, Virginia.
There's nothing to be afraid of, Smith.
What about the Indians?
Well, there are only a few tribes. The Iroquois, the Algonquins, the Seminoles, and one other tribe that is almost extinct today.
Oh, yes, you mean the Dixiecrats.
Go then, John Smith, and be of stout heart. It should bear the set you remember the glorious slogan of the crown, Per patria e pluribus in hoc alpha unum pluribus.
What does that mean?
Smoke a lucky and feel your level best.
The next week, I went down to the docks to sail in my ship. There it stood on the London docks. The SS Speedy Ring. I immediately went to my cabin. The sea was very rough and choppy. I had to stay below because I became violently ill. The next day, the ship left port. Finally, after 52 days at sea, we were 3 miles out of London. Somebody forgot to untie the boat. After weeks of starvation, scurvy, and shuffleboard, we arrived in America. I knew it was America. Duncan Hines was on shore waving. We went to work at once. Woods had to be cleared. Wells had to be dug. Rocks had to be moved. No man could be spared. In fact, whenever a man would faint from exhaustion, I would lay down for him so he could go on working. Finally, our work was completed, and one day there appeared at our settlement a beautiful Indian maiden. She was beautiful in her buckskin dress, and as she walked toward me, I could see she had 3 feathers on her head. It was amazing the way she balanced that bottle. I said to her, "What is your name, O Indian maid?"
"Me Pocahontas. What's your name?"
"John Smith."
"A likely story."
"Say, you're a girl, aren't you?"
"Yes. Now you know what I am. What are you?"
"I'm a man."
"Well, how do you know?"
"Well, I was..." "I always get a seat on the bus." "There are other ways to play this whole thing."
"Why you come to Indians' land, John Smith?"
"We mean peace." "We mean peace, Pocahontas." "How's the time?" "We mean peace, Pocahontas. We want to farm the land."
"Oh, you make good farmers."
"Why do you say that?"
"Got them built-in flour on faith."
"So say, you're kind of cute, Pokey. Tell me. That's for sure, Pokey. Hey, tell me, do you think you could ever fall in love with me, John?
I don't know. I don't know. I'm used to great big husky warriors.
Well, what about my physique? Look, why, my muscles are coming through my shirt.
Yes, but through the buttonhole?
Yeah. Say, Pokey, if you're not doing anything later, how about going for a canoe ride?
A canoe ride? Will you try to hug me and kiss me and make love to me?
Oh, no.
Then I won't go.
Oh, come on. We'll have a lot of fun.
Oh, I cannot go. My father, the chief, says I must only go out with red men.
Red men, huh? Meet you at 8 o'clock. I'll bring the sun lamp. Everything was going along fine at the settlement until one night I was captured by the Indians. They subjected me to all sorts of torture. Twisted my arms, burned the soles of my feet, and worst of all, they tied me to a stake and made me listen to a long playing Crosby record. When I came to, I decided the Indians were planning to broil me because not only was I tied to a stake, I was wearing paper panties. A few minutes later, Chief Powhatan spoke to me.
Hello,
Mort.
White man, pretty soon we burn you at stake. You die. What you say now?
Goodbye, Mort.
You must die, white man. Take Indians' land away. Now you burn, you pot-bellied, knock-kneed, cross-eyed, yellow-livered swine of a dog of a big...
Oh, hi.
Yes,
boss? About those insults, half of mine in the script, you know.
I couldn't help it, Bob. I got rolling.
You did, Well, keep on rolling. I'll open the door and you can roll right down to the unemployment office. It's all right. Now, where were we?
Oh, yes. You must die, white man. I'm going to burn you. You got a match?
Why should I give you a match so you can burn me?
Oh, Father, you mustn't burn him. I love him. I'll marry him to save him.
Will you marry my daughter Pocahontas if I save your life?
Sure I will.
All right, but if you marry her, you must live with pride, work 20 hours a day, sleep in teepee with pig and dog and cow. And first year, you must have 19 children.
20 hours a day, pig, dog, and cow, 19 children. Hey, Chief.
Yes?
Here's the match. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. We've knocked around the world a bit, but I want to say that we've never met people more friendly and gracious than folks here in the U-Haul Belt. They say you can't take it with you, but believe me, every time I see the South, I want to wrap it up and take it home. Tomorrow afternoon, we play Greensboro, North Carolina. Tomorrow night, Charleston, West Virginia. Thursday, it's all day in Washington, D.C. And Friday morning, we'll be in Winchester, Virginia for the Apple Blossom Festival. Friday night, Saturday matinee and night, we're doing 3 shows in Providence, Rhode Island to make up for the date we had to break last winter. Attention, Providence weatherman. No practical jokes this time, please. Sunday afternoon, we play Erie, Pennsylvania. Sunday night, Columbus, Ohio, with all my brothers and relatives. It'll be a touching scene. And Monday, Fort Smith, Arkansas. You need a terrific airplane on a merry-go-round like this? That's exactly what our United Airlines... Stop making motions in front of my face, will you? That's exactly what our United Airlines DC-6 is, and terrific. The word for the crew, Captain Ed Kesick, Sam Miller, co-pilot Claire Jarvis, navigator, B. Cowley and Winnie Porter, hostesses, and the engineers, Ray Powers, Jim Weir, and Bill O'Connor, and a special bow to our major D of travel, Mr. Bud Saunders. They're making this trip as smooth as a mint julep and as safe as U.S. savings bonds. And, folks, what a privilege it is to be meeting so many of the fine people whose ideals make that little old savings bond the finest investment in America. Good night, ladies and gentlemen.
Mirror, mirror on the wall, is my hair fairest of them all?
It is when you use Rave cream shampoo. Rave leaves your hair so clean, so soft, and yet so very easy to manage. Easy to manage because the pure lanolin in Rave is specially blended with other important ingredients to make hair behave, even on shampoo day. Your hair will be well-groomed if you use Rave. R-A-Y-V-E. Rave Cream Shampoo. This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.